Ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome our chief guest for this morning, Honorable Mr. Peter Dutton, MP, Federal Member for Dixon and Leader of the Liberal Party. And also Dr. Jagvinder Singh Virk, Chairman, India-Australia Strategic Alliance. May I request everyone to please be seated? Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for the distinguished public lecture on the theme India-Australia Relations, under the aegis of the Centre for India-Australia Studies at O.P. Jindal Global University. I extend a very warm welcome to our distinguished guests and members of the audience who have joined us today. I am very pleased to welcome our chief guest for this morning, Honourable Mr. Peter Dutton, Federal Member for Dixon and Leader of the Liberal Party. I am also delighted to welcome Dr. Jagvinder Singh Virk, Chairman, India-Australia Strategic Alliance. I am so pleased to welcome Professor C. Rajkumar, Vice-Chancellor, O.P. Jindal Global University, Professor Dabiru Sridhar Patnaik, Registrar, O.P. Jindal Global University, and Professor Mohan Kumar, Dean, Strategic and International Initiatives, O.P. Jindal Global University. I also extend a very warm welcome to everyone who has joined us via simultaneous broadcast on YouTube. Welcome and thank you so much for joining us today. To begin with, I invite Professor Dr. C. Rajkumar, Vice Chancellor, O.P. Jindal Global University, to please present the welcome address. Welcome, sir.
A very good morning to all of you. I would like to extend a warm welcome to our distinguished guest who is present here, Honorable Mr. Peter Dutton. I know that it is an extremely difficult schedule for anybody to be able to take out time for doing this amidst all this business and strategic and other professional meetings with government officials and others. I am deeply grateful to Mr. Dutton for taking out time, also to Dr. Virk for making this possible. I also extend the heartiest greetings of our founding chancellor and benefactor, Mr. Naveen Jindal, who is not going to be with us, but he has extended his greetings for this special occasion. And I was telling Mr. Dutton just a few minutes ago that this is a prelude to having him on our campus, which is an hour and 25 minutes from here, which I hope we will do it on the next occasion of his visit to India. I want to begin by saying that this lecture hosted by the Center for India-Australia Studies as a part of O.P. Jindal Global University is part of a larger effort to engage deeply and profoundly with Australia. As we know, India and Australia share numerous values. Most importantly, we are both vibrant democracies. We are deeply committed to pluralism and inclusivity. We have independent institutions, including courts and media, which are acting as checks and balances for our democracy. Besides that, of course, over the years, we have developed strong relations in relation to business and investment and trade and other strategic ties as well. Carefully noted, I have not used the C word yet. But besides that, we are conscious of this growing importance and relationship between both the countries. And I will briefly give you an overview of the university and how it ties with the Center for India-Australia Studies and what we have been doing within the university itself. But before I do that, I just want to extend my deepest appreciation to Mr. Dutton for accepting our invitation and to be able to be here at this facility. As some of you know, this is our Delhi facility. We call it the JGU International Academy, a private space for fostering public good in culmination of our own vision at the university, which is a private university promoting public service. Let me quickly tell the story of O.P. Jindal Global University. Mr. Dutton, this is how we began. In the year 2008, this is our campus. Nothing was there. Everything was about to be built. the idea was very clear. As a young student at Oxford, I dreamt about the idea of building a university in 1998. I was a Rhodes Scholar there, and I got to meet Australian Rhodes Scholars there, and that was the first time I got to know of your country. And during those several conversations with my friends there, but also my teachers and mentors, I was deeply appreciative of the importance of education, how it can be playing a transformative role. I dreamt about the idea of building a global university in India, and was conscious of the fact that it would take a lot of effort and resources to do that. I spent the next decade as a student at Harvard Law School, and then later as a lawyer in New York, and then as an academic in Japan, and then as an academic in Hong Kong. And all those years, I wrote a paper entitled Establishing India's First Global University, and got to meet with this extraordinary man about whom I don't need to tell you more, Mr. Naveen Jindal, literally on 31st October 2006. I spent the next year engaging with him, persuading him, and to bring home the larger vision of creating India's first global university with a view to promoting excellence in higher education. He committed to all of that in late 2007, invited me to move from Hong Kong to India in early 2008, and we began the process of institution building. That's how it all started. Our journey has, while it began in that form, we started our first academic session in the year 2009 with literally 100 students and 10 full-time faculty members, 50 acres of land, and almost 100,000 square feet of built-up space. We are now entering into the 15th year of our evolution, and we have nearly 11,000 students, over 1,100 plus faculty members, 100 acres of land, and nearly 4 million square feet of built-up space. This extraordinary evolution has been possible because of the far-sighted vision of our Chancellor, Mr. Jindal, but also the outstanding contribution of our faculty members, students, staff, and other stakeholders. The second aspect of our university, which we are very conscious of, is that we are a global university. Our middle name is global. We take that very seriously. These nearly 11,000 students come from 70 plus countries in the world. The 1,200 plus full-time faculty members come from 53 countries in the world. And we have collaborations with over 70 countries in which we partner with over 400 universities in the world. These collaborations are in every part of the world, including North America, South America, Europe and UK, Asia, Australia and New Zealand, Africa, as well as Middle East. There's only one part of the world we don't do collaborations, which is Antarctica, where we are looking at penguins to do an internship program with. But besides that, we are on a serious mission to connect India to the world and the world to India. This is part of a larger vision of the new India that we are part of, in which we have 1.5 billion people, which happens to be the largest populated country in the world. But the most important part of India is that the 950 million people in India are less than 35 years of age. You are not less than 35, Mr. Dutton. I am not less than 35. But young people in India who are less than 35, they constitute 950 million. When most parts of the Western world will become older, when most parts of the Eastern world, including China and Japan, will become older, young Indians, I believe, will be shaping the future of India and the future of the world. And hence, it's important for us to focus on education. At the dawn of Indian independence in 1947, our life expectancy was 32, and today it is 72. And I believe in the next decade, it will become over 80. That means the focus on education and its impact on the future and transformation of our country, but also others, Indians will play a very big role. And that is why internationalization is important. The next big thing for our universities is our strong commitment to interdisciplinarity. We strongly believe that interdisciplinary education is so critical, the boundaries of knowledge that need to be broken, and students should have an opportunity to learn across schools and programs, regardless of whichever school or program they are part of, and that is part of our commitment towards interdisciplinarity. And the next big thing is our contribution towards research and publications. As you can see, we are a research powerhouse, over 5,500 publications in 15 years. Nearly 2,000 of which are Scopus Index publications. Our faculty members have produced over 150 books. Almost every major publishing house, Oxford University Press, Cambridge University Press, Harvard University Press, you name it, they have been publishing. In addition, our major benefactors include Ford Foundation, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and other major national and international organizations with whom we have research partnerships as well. I will be, of course, moving quickly into where we stand today. We are ranked as India's first ranked private university. by the QS World Rankings. We are also ranked as first ranked private and public law school in India. But most importantly, we have been declared as an institution of eminence. Nearly 4 years ago, the Honorable Prime Minister of India made a major public policy announcement with a view to identifying 10 top public and private universities in India and give them the status of an institution of eminence. There are over 1,000 universities in India. After a very transparent process, 150 of them had applied, and that process led to the selection of 8 public and 4 private universities, which have been given the status of an institution of eminence. We are clearly among the youngest, but also the only non-STEM, non-medicine university which has been given the status of an institution of eminence by the government of India. And this is the single most important distinction that we have been able to get, which brings us outside the regulatory framework on the basis of which Indian universities are governed. But in all of this, what is and where is Australia? Well, I'm happy to report to you, Mr. Dutton, from the very beginning, we decided to develop a strong relationship with Australia. We set up the Center for India-Australia Studies under the leadership of a fantastic colleague of mine who's not here, who's back in Australia now, but he will be coming shortly for the program that we host with Australians, Professor Sean Starr. This partnership with Australia has become so robust, and as you can see the data, we collaborate with 25 out of 43 Australian universities with whom we have signed MOUs. Nearly 60% of Australian universities are our partners. 32 out of 43 Australian universities have actually visited our campus. 8 out of the 12 schools that we have collaborations with Australian universities. And if we look at the partnership itself, it's wide-ranging. We have had over 575 Australians visit our campus as a part of 314 official visits. And I must say that these partnerships are also ranging from general MOUs, dual degree programs, semester exchange programs, and study abroad programs. This gives you the panoramic view of the entire Australian higher education system with whom we have collaborations: ANU, Sydney, New South Wales, Wollongong, you just name it, every major Australian university we collaborate, and collaborate substantively. This is another important data point because this gives you the breadth and the depth of the collaborations. We have a student exchange programs, 50 of both our students have been part of it. We have short-term study abroad programs, nearly 160 students have been part of it. We have 34 of our faculty members have Australian degrees. And that's a very important part of our commitment to hire and recruit, outstanding people from Australia. We also have joint conferences. Over 400 Australian students have been on our campus. And I just spoke to Sean Starr this morning. He mentioned that this number will double by early next year. And these data points that you can see, over 307 inbound, 106 outbound, 510 online, and over 125 internships, is an example of the deep and pervasive relationship that we have with Australia, not only confined to the universities, but also even beyond. The collaboration is also spread across Australia. And I also must say that the Jindal Global Law School, the law school of our university, is the only law school from India which has been recognized by the Law Council of Australia. There are 1,750 law schools in India, and we are the only law school recognized by the Law Council of Australia. I want to end by saying that this visit of Mr. Peter Dutton, and to have him here, speaks volumes about our ongoing relationship, but also the future that will hold for this relationship. We sincerely hope that both India and Australia, as vibrant democracies, are able to do more things. But the centerpiece of that, I believe, ought to be the future of young people in both our countries, the future of entrepreneurship, the future of innovation, the future of technology, the future of educational transformation that can bring both our countries and societies together. I want to end by showing a short video of our campus. Since you're not visiting the campus, you will get a sense of what the campus is. So can you please switch off the lights?
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you're here, but you're not, cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones of today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back you. There's a time that I remember when I did not know how to be. don't believe in forever. Never don't stay the same. Now my heart feels like December. Somebody say your name. Cause I can't wait out to call you. But I know I will one day. Everybody hurts sometimes. Everybody hurts someday. Everything will be alright. Go and raise your glass and say, here's to the ones that we got there. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones in LA. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back memories. Bring back you.
Thank you, sir, for such a powerful welcome. I now invite Professor Mohan Kumar, Dean, Strategic and International Initiatives, OP Jindal Global University, to please share his reflections on the India-Australia strategic relations. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Surabhi, Hon'ble Peter Dutton, Member of Parliament from Australia, the founding Vice Chancellor, distinguished members of the Aussie delegation, and my own colleagues and distinguished guests in the audience. It's a great pleasure to address this audience on the Aussie-India relationship. There are a few countries with which India has been able to wreak tremendous transformation in the relationship. And if you ask me, very frankly, a handful of countries, you've got United States, Israel, but easily Australia would top the list. Because when I was in service for 36 years in the Indian diplomatic service, Australia was pretty much concerned or called as a retirement posting for diplomats. You go there, you enjoy the cricket, you enjoy the curry, you enjoy the kangaroo, and you enjoy Commonwealth. That was what Australia was all about. Today, it's one of the most significant strategic partnerships in the world. India has got a hub and spoke system of foreign policy where we are trying to locate a significant strategic partner in each region. So if we go from down under, needless to say, Australia, and then you've got Japan, in ASEAN, Indonesia, then you go to the Gulf, you have UAE, Saudi Arabia, in Europe, it's France, Germany, without a doubt, and then you go on to US and the rest of the world. So Australia is an important hub for the Indian foreign policy, and we have established a comprehensive strategic partnership in 2020, which is doing great. I think it's the future that I'm interested in. I'm absolutely convinced, as the Vice Chancellor said, that higher education will drive this strategic partnership. With a few tweaking here and there, I still believe India and Australia have a little bit of work to do. Australia should be attracting the best of the best students from India. Not necessarily those who want to migrate, that's fine too, because they make a great contribution to Australia. But I still believe in areas like artificial intelligence, quantum computing, engineering, the really cutting edge of technology, I think there is work to do. We should be able to get the best of Indian students to Australia. The second reason for strategic congruence between the two countries is that we want Asia to be multipolar. We don't want Asia to be dominated by one power. I'm going to be a diplomat and not call that power, but everyone knows who I'm talking about. So I think we need to ensure that Asia can accommodate India, Australia, Japan, Korea, everybody. And that means if you want a multipolar world, you need a multipolar Asia first. We also believe in a rules-based international order, which means that the sea lanes of communication have to be kept open. Again, Australia, India have been participating in joint military exercises absolutely unheard of before. And in the quadrilateral security dialogue that really brings together India, Australia, US, and Japan, we are again doing a lot of good work in the Indo-Pacific. I would like to say that the region of Indo-Pacific, the raison d'etre for Quad, would not be there without India and Australia. Indeed, in the past, it's no secret that Australia was a little shy at one point of time, and then India became shy of joining the Quad. I'm very happy that those hesitations and reservations have been overcome, and India and Australia are now participating, cooperating in a manner that they have never done before. It's an exciting time to be an Indian ambassador in Australia and vice versa, which is why we are sending one of our best officers from Colombo to Australia. He's a very, very fine diplomat who has worked in the Prime Minister's office in Delhi, Gopal Bagli, who will soon go to Australia and take over the mantle as High Commissioner. So, Honourable Member of Parliament, it's a great pleasure and honour to welcome you, and you come at an extremely exciting time for the relationship. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I am delighted to invite our chief guest, Honourable Mr. Peter Dutton, Federal Member for Dixon and Leader of the Liberal Party, to please present the distinguished public lecture on the theme India-Australia Relations. Welcome, sir.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honour to be here with you today. To the Vice-Chancellor, Professor Kumar, thank you very much. Firstly, for your vision, for your tenacity, for your drive, and for your capacity to make company with somebody who is an incredible individual and has been a great collaborator with my friend Dr. Burke and others on a number of projects, but to bring to fruition this wonderful university, it is a great credit to you and to the drive that you have. I'm really pleased to be back in New Delhi, and it is wonderful to be here with my very good friend and parliamentary colleague Jason Wood, who's the Shadow Minister for Multicultural Affairs and was the Junior Home Affairs Minister in the last government. Well, we've put a pretty significant program together, and it reflects our own priorities for the relationship. I want to say thank you to Dr. Virk, to all of our participating colleagues, and I want to say thank you very much in particular today to the Centre for India-Australia Studies and the OP Jindal Global University more broadly for this speaking opportunity. I pay tribute to the life and to the legacy of Om Prakash Jindal. OP was a pioneer, an entrepreneur, a businessman, a statesman, and a visionary who helped forge modern India. But most importantly, he was an immensely proud father of four sons. During this trip, I had the great honour to meet his son, Naveen. Naveen is, of course, very much his father's son, the founder and first chancellor of this marvellous university, and a world-renowned businessman, philanthropist, and patriot in his own right. Now, I'm eager to hear from you shortly, and I'm sorry that you have to put up with me in stereo up on the screens here. One vision is enough, let alone three, so please persevere. Like me, I'm sure you've been looking at events around the world with increasing concern, and no doubt with more concern than we've seen in recent times. In Eastern Europe, Ukrainians continue to fight valiantly to repel Russian forces from their territory. That war has now lasted more than 600 days. Ukraine is fighting for its freedom. In the Middle East, 27 days ago, death-worshipping terrorists from Hamas attacked Israel. For the Israelis, October 7 was their September 11. It was the greatest loss of Jewish life on a single day since the end of the Holocaust, where 6 million people were gassed to death. Israel, as we know, is fighting for its right to exist, and the Indo-Pacific tensions remain very high. Most recently, a Chinese Coast Guard vessel rammed a Philippine supply ship near the Spratly Islands. It is yet another reminder that all is not well in the state of our own region. With the fall of the Berlin Wall, the end of the Cold War, and the collapse of the Soviet Union, many prophesied the coming of a world of democracies. They called it the end of history, but they were wrong in their forecasts, regrettably. Whether it's in Eastern Europe, in the Middle East, or in the Indo-Pacific, we're actually seeing a return of history. The days of despots are not gone. The age of autocrats is not behind us, Times of terrorism have not disappeared, and recent world events are a reminder that civilization doesn't tilt naturally towards democracy. Democracy is always under threat. Democracy does not thrive on its own. Democracy needs to be nurtured and defended. The first leader of an independent India knew this all too well. In fact, in 1947, Prime Minister Nehru said that the future is not one of ease, of resting, but of incessant striving. At one level, he was speaking about building the noble mansion of free India. But at a deeper level, he was speaking about democracy more broadly. Mr. Nehru said, and I quote, "We shall never allow that torch of freedom to be blown out, however high the wind or stormy the tempest." His message was one about the need for will, about the need for determination, about the need for continual courage through endeavour. It was a warning against idleness, a warning against complacency, and a warning against becoming supine. And his message is one we must heed today. Indians, Australians, and citizens of other democratic nations are all beneficiaries of our forebears. Those who came before us helped to forge the democracies which we are so lucky to live in today. But we're more than just beneficiaries, we are also custodians. And as custodians, it's our job to preserve, and indeed, if we can, to improve what has been gifted to us. If there is such a thing as an intergenerational duty, and I believe there is, it is to pass on to our children something better than that which was bequeathed to us. But that which was bequeathed to us is at risk. Our children risk growing up in a world which is darker than the one we know. The flashpoints around the globe are the tests of our generation. And just as previous generations rose to the occasion, I'm supremely confident that we can rise to this one too. This is a time not just for democracies to say they stand together through their words. This is our time as democracies to show that we together can perform great deeds. This is a time for India and Australia to demonstrate the strength of our democracies. Australia and India's camaraderie was cultivated in 1915 on the hills and in the valleys of Gallipoli. More than a century on, we have a deep and abiding bilateral relationship. In my 22 years in public life, I've seen India and Australia's bond grow even tighter, a statement of expanding economic security and social ties. So let me outline just a few areas where I think we can and indeed must do more together. First and most importantly, it's in defence and security. In these precarious times, we should aim to increase the tempo and the frequency of our joint training activities and deployments, and not just at the bilateral level, but also multilaterally with our other partners in the region. And these initiatives, as you know, do two things. They help the components of an individual military force, a navy, an army, and an air force, to operate more effectively as a joint force. And they help each of our joint forces, the Australian Defence Force, the Indian Armed Forces, and those of our partners, to operate more effectively as a combined force. These two levels of interoperability with a single military force and between multiple military forces are critical at this time. And any increase to the tempo and frequency of our training activities and deployment sends a clear message of deterrence to any adversary. In 2020, the former Australian Coalition Government, of which I was a senior member, signed two defence agreements with India. A defence science and technology agreement to improve collaboration between our research organisations and to facilitate greater industrial-based partnerships, and a mutual logistics support agreement to enhance our military engagement. I think such arrangements are just foundations for what we can do together. Speaking, of course, of bigger initiatives, like reciprocal access agreements and greater industrial-based collaboration, as we're seeing in Eastern Europe and the Middle East, the character of war continues to change. In modern warfare, there is a growing emphasis and importance on asymmetric capabilities, especially drones, missiles, autonomous craft, and cyber. Unlike planes, ships, submarines, and tanks, these capabilities are smaller and can be produced in quantity, relatively quickly, and more inexpensively than other comparable platforms. Indeed, greater engagement between the small businesses in our defence industrial ecosystems will hasten rather than hinder our mutual defence capability objectives, particularly towards developing asymmetric platforms. Right now, we need to be taking steps to scale up our military industrial capacity, to strip away the concerns that those businesses have to scale up their businesses at a time when our countries need them most. We also need to be realistic about the true nature of authoritarian regimes. This is not a time for appeasement. They have no interest in providing any transparency regarding their actions. They have no desire to provide strategic reassurance regarding their behaviours. Authoritarian regimes will use inducements and threats and bribery and force to realise their ambitions. They tend to target nations sequentially, one state at a time. And their position is stronger when they encounter little resistance. And this is why whenever we witness authoritarian coercion and aggression, it is vital that nations, large and small, rally together to unequivocally condemn such behaviour. If one nation's sovereignty is being threatened, then a chorus of nations needs to have that nation's back. Australia and India's collaboration with Japan and the United States as part of the Quad is an emphatic statement of our desire for peace in the region. Indeed, most nations across the region, some democracies, some not, share in this goal of maintaining the stability which has been the motor of human progress for the last 8 decades. And that's why India and Australia have an increasingly important role, a very important role to play in buttressing relationships in the region. Australia has relationships of depth, considerable depth, with our family in Pacific neighbours. We continue to cultivate that given our shared interests. And I truly hope that India recognises the sheer magnitude of its own influence to do good. The trip by Prime Minister Modi to Papua New Guinea was inspiring, and he deserves full congratulations for that initiative. India does have a defining role to play in promoting the security and prosperity of the Indo-Pacific. Your country is one of the greatest accomplishments of growth and advancement of any nation in modern history. India has emerged as the world's largest democracy, and as we know, it's one of the fastest growing major economies. The success story of this great country is an inspiration from which others draw confidence. Of course, the strength of Australia and India's democracies also lies in strengthening our economic relationship. Under Australia's former coalition government, our two nations elevated our bilateral relationship to a comprehensive strategic partnership in June of 2020. Then in April of 22, we signed an historic economic cooperation and trade agreement, which is creating new ventures between our industries and businesses. Some segments of that trade, at least on early evidence, indicates a 40% increase in some commodities, and that is a very significant achievement in a short period of time. The agreement, of course, means that by the beginning of 2026, 100% of imports from India into Australia will be tariff-free. Today, our two-way trade in goods and services is valued at almost $47 billion. Now, there are nations today, including some of our allies and partners, who are being tempted to return to the protectionist policies of the past. This is a catastrophic mistake. Protectionism is a product of a bygone era. And in our modern, hyper-connected and digitally driven era, protectionism is regressive. Yes, the world has changed with the resurgence of authoritarian regimes, great power competition, and now conflict in the Middle East and Eastern Europe. And yes, nations are looking to develop their sovereign capabilities to bolster their resilience and their resistance against future shocks. But that doesn't mean all nations should, or can, or indeed are abandoning economic liberalism. On the contrary, democratic economies are simply reassessing their type and depth of engagement in particular risky markets. The term friendshoring might be new, but favouring certain supply chains with allies and trusted partners is not a new concept. So I truly believe that Australia and India are just beginning to unlock the vast potential of our economic and trading relationship. And we should find confidence in tried and tested economic principles, which have underpinned the success of our two nations for generations. One area where I believe there is enormous potential for future mutual economic benefit is in energy security. India is, of course, a nuclear power nation with some 22 reactors in operation and a further 8 being constructed. Australia, at this point in time, is not a nuclear power nation. Onshore nuclear power production was banned in Australia by law in 1998. Yet in the 1930s, we will acquire the first of a fleet of nuclear-powered submarines under the AUKUS deal. At home, I'm pushing for a sensible debate on the role that zero-emission new nuclear technologies can play in our energy mix, providing a baseload to firm up renewables into the system. Our particular focus is on small modular reactors and nuclear batteries. If we don't lift our moratorium to accommodate these new nuclear technologies, Australia risks becoming a nuclear power pariah. It also puts us at considerable risk of achieving our emissions reductions, which we've committed to internationally. Both Australia and India, of course, have similar goals. Our citizens want cost-effective power, consistent power, and clean power. And as nations around the world look to shut down coal generators or phase out gas, nuclear power is the only feasible and proven technology which can firm up renewables at the scale that is needed. More than 50 countries are currently exploring or investing in the development of new nuclear technologies. Indeed, the World Nuclear Association says that demand for reactors is expected to climb by 28% by 2030 and almost 100% by 2040. And here's the most bizarre fact from an Australian perspective. Australia holds the world's largest uranium deposits, yet we only supply about 8% of global demand. In terms of energy policy, there's so much Australia and India can continue to do together. Your nuclear power industry can play a critical role in telling Australians about its benefits. And if Australia is wise enough to lift its nuclear power ban, as well as restrictions on new mining ventures, we are exceptionally well positioned to unleash our uranium export potential and support India's growing demand. Finally, we strengthen our two democracies by growing our people-to-people connections. That is evidenced here today and on this amazing, within this amazing institution. For 7 years, I was Australia's Minister for Immigration and then Home Affairs. During those years, Indian migration to Australia blossomed and our diaspora grew. Between 2015 and 2022, Indian temporary visa holders increased from around 140,000 to 283,000. An average of more than 32,000 Indians migrated permanently to Australia each year, and more than 209,000 Indians became Australian citizens. Tellingly, the number of Australians with Indian ancestry today numbers more than 780,000, some 164,000 more since the 2016 census, something of which I'm incredibly proud. In that financial year, more than 100,000 visas were granted to Indians to study in Australia. A great outcome for the individuals and a great outcome for our two countries. Indeed, there is a strong bipartisan support between the two major political parties in Australia when it comes to nurturing migration with India. When Prime Ministers Modi and Albanese met in Sydney in May, they finalised a migration and mobility partnership agreement. That arrangement will facilitate a greater two-way flow of students, of graduates, of academics and business people. It's an initiative I welcome wholeheartedly. It will open new pipelines of friendship, opportunity and enterprise, which multiply the connections between our two nations, a true sign of the growing strength of our democracies. Ladies and gentlemen, I earlier quoted India's first Prime Minister. Let me conclude by quoting your current Prime Minister. In 2016, Prime Minister Modi profoundly said, "There were many who doubted India as a newly independent nation. Indeed, wagers were made on our future. But the people of India did not waver." Friends, let us not waver now when the challenges facing democracy around the world require our will, our determination, and our courage through endeavour. Let us take steps to broaden the relationship between Australia and India and show that our two great nations, comprising two great democratic people, can accomplish so much. And may our example be one of many. As has always been the case, demonstrating the strength of democracy will see us prevail over any difficulty. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you so much, Mr. Dutton, for a fascinating 24. So what I thought we will do is you can stand where you are. We'll take some questions and have a Q&A session. So the floor is open. Please quickly introduce yourself and, you know, keep the question short, please.
Famous last words.
Yeah, thank you, Hon'ble Mr. Peter Dutton, and thank you, Vice Chancellor and other colleagues for the invite. It was truly a privilege listening to you, and what is very heartening from my perspective is that you emphasize the area of energy security. I'm a former diplomat. I should have introduced myself. Sanjeev Arora, former ambassador and secretary in the Ministry of External Affairs. And currently, I am doing a course at Jindal Global University on energy security and diplomacy, a new course that we have started. Now, my question relates to the increasing flagrant violations of international law, humanitarian law, absolutely wanton revolutions, violations of human rights. You see, whether it is Russia's invasion of Ukraine leading to an extremely critical humanitarian crisis, or the diabolical terrorist attacks by Hamas, and the retaliation, you see, that really amounts to almost mass, intended mass annihilation of an entire population. So these are issues you have dealt with during your long and distinguished career. I mean, how does the Liberal Party under your leadership, look at all these issues, and what types of advice in this context you give to your government and you would give to leading democracies around the world? Thank you.
We are sincere. Thank you. Thank you very much for your service to your country, and thank you for your question as well. There's a very significant debate going on within the defense industry, within the national security space, right across Five Eyes partners and across collaborations, including the Quad and in our case, particularly with the United States and the United Kingdom, about how to provide that peace. And I think now is a time for leaders to stand up, as Prime Minister Modi and others have, to call out those acts of aggression, to do so in a respectful way, but to not pretend that in a cloak of darkness that the behaviours will correct or go away. This is a very significant concern for us, particularly in the South China Sea at the moment. The possibility, as we've seen with the not just the Philippines, but in the East China Sea with Japan as well, the possibility of an accident taking place is very real, and the stakes are very high. So we need to make sure that there are lines of communication open between great powers. We need to make sure that we commit ourselves to the values of our democracy, as I mentioned in my speech, and to make sure that we can work, particularly in the case of China, which is a very significant trading partner of Australia, to preserve that peace. We've known 8 decades of peace, relatively, in our part of the world since the Second World War, and there are many pressures that are there at the moment. But as was the case in the 1930s, people had a sliding doors moment. And I hope that we learn the lessons of history, because nobody wants any act of war or aggression in the Indo-Pacific. We want peace to prevail, and we need to be strong to be able to provide that deterrence. And we're stronger if we're standing shoulder to shoulder with countries the quality of India and some of the others that I mentioned before.
Thank you very much for that. Yeah, let's have another question up there, please. It's okay, you can ask.
Thank you for the insightful session. Open Jindal Global University at the Law Department. So my question is related to quadrilateral security dialogue. So in recent time, we have seen that Russia having the undeterred power over Ukraine, while Israel over Gaza. So Mike, and recently yesterday, one of the Asian power has sent around 43 aircrafts to Taiwan. So my question is, how successful Quad has been in fulfilling the motto of preserving Asian arc of democracy?
Can you give the mic to the next person in front of you?
Thank you. Well, the Quad in its current form is early in formation. So I don't think we should be critical about whether or not we've been able to deliver world peace through the Quad just yet. But I do think that, particularly given Prime Minister Modi's commitment to the relationship and to the credit of former Prime Minister Morrison in bringing that together, as we know, Japan has very serious concerns about the developments in the East China Sea, as I pointed out before, and see an action in Taiwan as an existential threat. So for us to be able to perform military exercises together, for us to be able to send a very clear message, not one of division, but one of unity, that gives us the greatest capacity to push back on acts of aggression. The Philippines and Cambodia, Indonesia, others are very interested and obviously have significant economic stakes in this debate and this period of history, but much beyond that. And so the Quad allows like-mindeds to come together. The training exercises that we do now are absolutely essential, and they must be scaled up. We must make sure that there is a greater industrial base across countries with of like minds, and that provides strength, as I say. And I think that's the most important point, is the ability to collaborate for democracies not to pretend that that nothing is happening. And that we remain silent and that somehow it will go away. There are plenty of periods in history where that has proven to be a fatal error. And we can speak respectfully, but we need to speak with one voice, and that will give us the best chance of preserving peace within our region.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Next question, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Alexey Voron. I'm assistant professor of Jindal Global.
Speak a little louder, please.
Yes. So my question, since I'm teaching international human rights law and theory, and just yesterday we discussed with my students case Daniel Billy against Australia, where Human Rights Committee found Australia liable for violation of right to culture, to maintain culture and be free from interventions to private life and home. I want to ask you, and since you also talked about intergenerational equity, I want to ask you as opposition leader how maybe in this case Australia could be represented better, maybe by government, or what could be done better by Australian government to make sure that human rights and field of climate change will be protected better, and especially in taking into account that in this particular case applicants would probably face the same consequences, so that their territory where they lived is flooded. Even without Australian contribution, it wasn't just because of Australia's emission, but of the emission and the climate change that caused by the actions of the whole world. So what is your perspective on that? Thank you.
Well, there are many people in this room who know Australia well, and many people who have left the motherland to come and enjoy an amazing opportunity in life in Australia. We're a population of 25.8 million people, and we're an incredible migrant story where we've welcomed people from four corners of the earth. And there are many people in our delegation today who left India with the shirt on their back. And today they're very successful entrepreneurs employing Australians, investing back into India, providing support for programs. We went to one such program yesterday where hundreds of thousands of pairs of glasses have been handed out to young impoverished children here in India. And so the reach of that success of our nation knows no bounds. And when you look at what Australia is able to produce and the contribution that for such a small island nation, continent, that we're able to make on the world stage, it makes me immensely proud to be an Australian citizen. And like every country, there's no doubt things that we can change and do better, but Australia has a culture where if we sign up to an agreement or to a commitment, we meet that commitment. And there are many countries, including in Europe, who might seek to provide advice, even free advice, to Australia about the issue of global emissions. The reality is that Australia meets its emission commitments and our commitments otherwise that we enter into as part of a UN process or a global process, international process otherwise. And that is something that we take very seriously. So I think if you look at what Australia is able to achieve in an objective way, without the baggage of those who might have other agendas to push, Australia has a very good track record, an exceptional track record, and we've contributed to the peace and stability of the world in which we live today. And the reason that the values are so relevant between our two countries is not just because of our shared history, but because of our desire to see a world where people can be lifted from poverty, where there can be a decarbonisation process legitimately taking and credibly taking place. But the thought that we can, on the issue of climate change, that we can close coal mines and that we can close gas down tomorrow, as the energy regulator in Australia has pointed out, that would mean disruption to supply. And for elderly people, for sick people, being able to get through a harsh summer or winter, they require constant, reliable energy. And we have to do the transition in a way that is going to provide a reality to the economy and also to the commitments that we've made to our near neighbours. But we would be one of the most significant contributors to Pacific Island nations in all sorts of programs, including climate change mitigation, but economic development, empowerment of women, and many other causes that we fund very generously.
Thank you very much. We are, of course, coming to the end of it. I'll take a couple of questions, yeah, and then we'll wind up. Yeah, Moshmi.
Hello. Minister, my name is Moshmi Mukherjee. I'm an alumni of Melbourne Uni and also working here as Deputy Director of the International Institute of Higher Education Research and Capacity Building. My question to you is, there's been a lot of exchange, particularly in higher education, between India and Australia in recent years. We have hosted several Australian students as part of the new Colombo plan. But what is your vision to further increase higher educational exchange between India and Australia? I'd like to hear from you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your question. There is, when you consider the trajectory of student numbers, I provided some of the detail in my speech, but there is considerable growth, which we welcome, and the students provide an important role, not only obviously in their education, but also in the advancement of the Australian economy and our society as a whole. Played a very, very significant role, and I think it's one of the great modern accomplishments of Australia is to have welcomed so many students from India and the successes that they've enjoyed. Now, when you look at the scale, is it always going to be a perfect model? Of course not. There'll always be individuals who are outliers who don't represent the values of the 99.9%. But there is, I think, enormous opportunity in Prime Minister Modi's vision, in our vision for the Australian economy as well, being able to export that labour, that intellect and the capacity, the entrepreneurial spirit is something that Australia is a net beneficiary of. So I think there is an opportunity through private institutions like this one and other public institution collaborations for us to continue to scale up. And there's a lot of domestic interest in making sure that that's the case.
Thank you. And we'll take just two more questions. That's, yeah.
We are on the eve of a very crucial visit to the Prime Minister's visit to China. What are your expectations from this visit? There are also reports of some lease of Yabe port to a Chinese company. How do you look at that as former Defence Minister? And just one more question. Were you disappointed that India did not take part in Talisman Sabre earlier this year?
Well, it's obviously the case that the Prime Minister, in his visit to China, as he said, has some strong messages to deliver, and we support him in that endeavour. But as I pointed out before, China is Australia's largest trading partner. We have a diasporic community of about 1.2 million people in Australia of Chinese heritage, wonderful Australians, and like many of our migrants, including from India, people who adhere to the rule of law, people who work hard, people who value family, and in a generation, people who have created enormous success for themselves and set up generational wealth, and most importantly, added to the social fabric of our country. So that's an incredibly important relationship. But we can't also then deny the advice of the Director General of the Australian Security Intelligence Organisation in Washington, with Director Ray from the FBI, only in the last fortnight, that the theft of intellectual property and the cyber attacks are really at industrial scale in Australia, as they are here in India, no doubt, and in other economies. And that behaviour is not something that should be condoned. It's not something that should be tolerated. And if it was to happen in reverse, people would be very angry about the conduct of our government or yours. It's right and proper that countries have a collection of intelligence, and that continues on as it should. But the reality is that this is an attack on Australian jobs. It's an attack on our economy when that level of detail is hoovered up from companies who might be on the cusp of a discovery or a development in the medical space, in the defence space, or elsewhere. So I think that's important. In relation to the second part of your question, there are reasons which have been documented in relation to the Talisman Sabre issue. I think the opportunity for us through the Quad and otherwise, and every indication that I got as Defence Minister from Minister Singh and from my meetings with Prime Minister Modi as well, is that there's no hesitation in working together. I think there is, particularly as the relationship between China and Russia develops, and that's evidenced not just in relation to Ukraine but otherwise, that India may have a different perspective around some aspects of that relationship. And I think countries like Australia are natural partners where we can deepen our engagement, not just through training, but I think there's, for example, enormous opportunity for manufacturing to take place in India in the defence materiel space, and not just for domestic contract purposes, but for export to countries including Australia. So I think there's significant upside, and I only have positive things to say about the relationship, including in relation to defence.
Great. One last question. All right, please.
Mr. Dutton, I'm one of the few proud Australians also on the Jindal University campus. I just wanted to pick further your comments about the possibility of the bilateral collaboration on the nuclear technologies, to seek your thoughts more broadly on the role Quad could more systematically play on the renewable energy battery storage technologies, because that's a space that's clearly the rate limiting constraint, and that's also a space that China clearly has a strategic lead, not only in the control of the raw materials value chain, but also on the scale and learning curve of the manufacturing of lithium batteries. So it seems that many of the Quad members have the various different components that could be collaborated on to counter that. But currently that doesn't seem to be a very significant priority area. So your thoughts on that relative to the nuclear technology collaboration as an alternative?
But I mean, we've met with Indian business people who have told us about some of the projects that they're working on, including some with assistance from the Indian government in the hydrogen space, for example. And there's enormous investment in our country into the research and development around hydrogen and green hydrogen in particular. It's a frustration for everybody, let's be very frank about it, that the battery storage technology isn't more advanced than where it is. But nonetheless, we may be on the cusp of an opportunity. It may be a long way off, we don't know. But at the moment, the firming capacity from the battery is not a commercial reality. And in Australia, we've seen one of the energy companies install in South Australia, in Adelaide, at the cost of $190 million, the latest technology. The firming capacity exhausts after 1 hour. And so should we encourage collaborations, particularly with our Indian counterparts? Absolutely. And if there's the opportunity for that under Quad or under a bilateral arrangement otherwise, then I would give every support to that being enhanced and advanced as well. So that's sort of a no-brainer in the sense, but I do think there is a lot more happening than we might acknowledge, because a lot of those small startups will continue on, some will fail, but there will be a discovery of significance, and I hope it's sooner than later to help us with that transition. But at the moment, a critical part of the debate is how do we firm up such a significant percentage of renewables in the system. And in Australia's case, we've got a hydro project which is very expensive, but likely the only one of its scale available, just given the geography in Australia. And hydrogen is obviously volatile and difficult to transport. It uses a lot of water. And the small modular reactors, as we've seen being embraced by many countries, give you the ability to, particularly in regional areas, in remote areas, the ability to firm up those renewables in the system. So that's the proven technology. And the irony is, in my mind, that when we take delivery of the new AUKUS submarines, the Rolls-Royce reactor that's on the submarine, which is fueled for 30 years, the propulsion system on that submarine means that you could dock the submarine in Adelaide or Sydney or Brisbane, wherever it might be, and plug it in and run the city in any case. So, but you can't establish something on shore, which is anomalous, and I think it requires a mature debate. And that's why I think we should continue to push that. And if there are synergies with our Indian counterparts, then that should form part of the answer as well.
Thank you very much, you very Mr. Dutton, for not only a fascinating lecture, but your candid reflections, your thoughtful comments, and most importantly, your nuanced observations about many of the complex questions that our faculty raise. I almost thought it was a dissertation committee meeting when Mr. Dutton was defending his dissertation. So thank you so much for being here. We are on schedule, so I'm going to request my colleague to take proceedings forward.
Thank you, Mr. Dutton, for your powerful lecture and for enforcing in each one of us the need for togetherness and a unified approach towards matters of the world to ensure global peace. Thank you very much for a wonderful lecture. I now invite Dr. Jagvinder Singh Virk, Chairman, India-Australia Strategic Alliance, to please present the concluding remarks. Welcome, sir.
You know, it's very hard to handle one professor. I'm feeling suffocated here. So, in my medical, I'm an MD medicine doctor, and after so many of heavy speeches, and I think you have not drink the bottle. The water has evaporated from this bottle. So I'm giving another bottle. So, I have a couple of points to make as chair of India-Australia Strategic Alliance. My first point I should make as a chair of India-Australia Strategic Alliance. I met with Ratan Tata ji a few times, and then first time my meeting with Ratan Tata ji in UNSW. I have nothing to knew about what is the universities are all about and all those things. The first time I met, we formed the government, what Honorable Peter Dutton said in 2013, and there I've been appointed as a chair of UNSW Innovation Department. And first time I knew, I'm living in the city in Sydney, and the UNSW has more than 600 technologies lying down in cupboard and not being used for the world. Those days, I'm meeting Minister for Water Resources, Congress government was in power here, and I was surprised to see the technologies that we have in Australia, India don't have, unfortunately. So you are, Professor Saab, you are so lucky. You've been to Oxford, you've been to US, Harvard, you've been to Hong Kong. You're one of the luckiest child who has got those opportunities and been there, and God has given you a brain to study there in those universities and come back to your motherland. First of all, round of applause for Mr. Rajkumar. You know, I'm not a speech writer or speech teller like Peter Dutton. He's a big leader, not as a status, and anyway, he's a big at heart as well from the policies. So why I'm telling you these stories about UNSW, what we have and all those things, and on that note, and there are a lot of questions what I have seen coming through. Australia is world's number one country, where US have some technologies and US has those restrictions, right? But what I have seen in my tenure as a 3 years in innovation department, when I met with Ratan Tataji first time, and we conferred him honorary doctorate from UNSW, and I said, sir, I'm a politician, please tell me some tips about business, right? He said, when I was young, I used to visit Australia a lot. Australia is the best country for take technologies from here, but it's the worst country for doing business, 70s, 80s. Right now, that's why Ratan Tataji loved so much UNSW and Australia system. What is our scientist? I will just give you a small story. We have a doctor here in Chennai. His name is a world-renowned cardiologist. So heart surgeries he does. So they are doing a artificial heart. One artificial heart at Abbott company, they are doing it. It's $100,000, like 90 lakh in the US. But what they have doing for last 4 years, and they're in the final stages, you will get to know in news in a couple of months. They are working with Australian scientists, and they made that artificial heart only just in $30,000. That's what Australia is. That's what Australia scientists is. This is my first point take. Second point, Mr. Jindal, Naveen Jindal, maybe you know, he's a chancellor, he's a billionaire, he's the son of a billionaire, he's a politician. When I met Mr. Naveen Jindal 11, 12 years back, I never met a person like him. I know I met a lot of billionaires across the world, billionaires from Russia, billionaires, we have a lot of billionaires in Australia. But that billionaire, the vision of that person about education, and you know what the slide show, how 2007, he said in 2 minutes, Dr. Rajkumar. No. These type of things take 50 to 80 years, what they've done in 7 to 8 years. Again, round of applause for Mr. Jindal and yourself. So, this is the second point, what I took. And thank you very much, Honorable Peter Dutton and Honorable Jason Wood, our beloved leader from Australia, both of them. And their visit to India. And sir, what we can do, Vice-Chancellor, sir, on India-Australia strategic alliance. You know, you said there must be few things to be done. I don't agree with you on this, respectfully. Not few things. A lot of things to be done. You're very diplomatic saying that. Nothing has been done, right? MOUs have been signed, right, for last 10 years, 15 years, not with your university, with another university as well. But MOU doesn't give anything. If a boy or girl meet, they sign an MOU. After 3 years they meet, they sign another MOU with another boy and girl. Another 3 years they sign another MOU with another. After 10 years there's no child. Only MOUs are there. We have to produce kids. We have to produce intellectual kids in the universities. So these MOUs should be matured. It should be married. That's my take on this. And please make a task force on Australia. And Honorable Peter Dutton, and I must say on behalf of him, I think he is the best leader to support you in education. Right? So please make a task force, make a 6 or 8 people task force, 3 people sitting there, 3 people sitting here, where we can help you. Right, where we can help you to help your vision to Mr. Jindal's vision, what he can done. And why I'm saying that Mr. Jindal has also is a big investor in New South Wales, well, in the mining sector, $1.4 billion he has invested. And why I respect that person a lot. He has been struggling in that mine for last 7-8 years, now he got all the approvals. But what a great man he is. He never complained a single time to anyone. That is the greatness of, if I spend $50,000, madam, I've given you, you are a Melbourne alumni, you will be in Melbourne, right? If someone invests $10,000, he doesn't come back, so he will tell to 10 people you are a bad person, right? But Mr. Jindal always is a great host for all of our Australian leaders, for Hon'ble Tony Abbott as well in the past, and therefore yesterday he hosted our beloved leader. He said, and you know, he's written there, federal member of Dixon. In the future as well, he will be a federal member of Dixon. But here, the leader of Liberal Party, it will change end of next year. It will be the Prime Minister of Australia, Hon'ble Peter Dutton. I remember my words today on third number, what I said. Again, thank you very much, Professor. My take is we should work more, right? MOUs, very happy to see that slide, too many MOUs, right? But we have to produce kids. Thank you very much. Thank you. And last for the neat, about Australia. You know, we are very lucky. I have two mothers. One is my Janam Bhumi, another is my Australia Karamu. I tell you, if Peter says something about Australia, people think differently because he's Australian, right? I tell you, I'm also Australian. I've gone from here. My wife, Dr. Ratan, we are both doctors, ma'am, right? I'm not a professor, but a medical doctor. I tell you about Australia. Australia is the only country in the world. A lot of people have been in the US, you have been in the US. The people who are delegates here, all the Australian delegates who are here, and I can guarantee you on the paper, I never been to US, I never been to UK, I've seen, I'm listening stories, you know, it takes two generations to be successful, three generations to be successful in overseas country, am I right? Everyone listening here, it took two generations, third generation. Sir, the people who are sitting in this room, and what exactly our honorable leader said, I don't know that word, shirt and all those things, but they gone with one bag, right? We have examples here, sitting here. We have another example, he's an Indian guy, Mr. Adrian. He was 2 years old. He went to Mumbai. He was one of the top banker in Macquarie Bank. He's one of the wealthiest person, the first generation. We have guys like Anurag. This is the first generation Australia given us. In 10 to 15 years, we produce millionaires there. We have seen Chinese people, young people. We've seen Greeks, Italians, all those peoples. You know why our people make money there? Tell me, why this first generation has made a lot of money in Australia, not in UK. We know a lot of UK people, we know a lot of US people. Because Australia doesn't stop anybody to make money. Australia doesn't stop anybody to grow. That's what we respect Australia so much, and I love so much. I have two sons there in Australia. I do every event, like Mr. Jindal is for flag. People knows about Mr. Jindal, what he's doing. I do every year one event called Thank You Australia. And I can't say thanks too much to Australia, because that land gives opportunities. I was at Pravasi Bharati Devas, Honorable Peter Dutton. Pravasi Bharati Devas, Indian government does. And BBC asked me one question. What is the difference between India and Australia? I said, I will give you an answer in 1 minute. For us as Indians, Australia has everything. But for us, it's nothing, because we left, sacrifice our country. India has nothing, but for us, it's everything. Coming to the development point, I said, I am from Punjab, Chandigarh. I said, in Delhi, we are in Delhi, and that time, Prime Minister Narendra Modi was Chief Minister, he was sitting on the dais. I said, in Delhi, we have two golf clubs. Only rich people can play in golf clubs. We don't have a cricket ground in Delhi. There's no cricket ground. In Sydney, only, forget about Australia, we have 700 cricket grounds, 900 soccer fields, 200 golf clubs for free for the public. That's what Australia is. Right? So for a normal person, Australia is heaven on the earth. That's why people migrate to Australia. Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I now invite Honorable Vice Chancellor, Honorable Registrar, and Professor Mohan Kumar to please present the mementos to our guest today. Thank you. Thank you so much. I now invite Professor Dabiro Sridhar Patnaik, Registrar, O.P. Jindal Global University, to please present the vote of thanks.
Thank you so much, Surabhi. Good afternoon, everyone, and good afternoon even to our distinguished guests, Honorable Peter Dutton, Dr. Work, and delegation from Australia. It's a great moment. We heard about the India-Australia relations both from the Vice Chancellor and my colleague Professor Mohan Kumar, and of course the erudite lecture by Honorable Peter Dutton himself. But to us, it is a moment to vindicate our stance in terms of reflecting on the past, planning for the present, and looking towards the future. And that is one such moment which we have, and we all should together capture this opportunity to work on strengthening the relations. And there cannot be a better moment or an opportunity than now in terms of having the distinguished presence of Honorable Peter Dutton and his team to sort of reflect on the work that we can do together, both as a larger society and even in terms of our collaborations with Australian universities. So we thank you so much, Honorable Peter Dutton, for your time that you have taken, because we know it's not easy considering the hectic and the demanding schedules that you have while visiting India along with your delegation. But we are so gladdened and we are so happy that you have taken time out to address all of us. But sooner than later, we wish that you visit our campus in Sonipat, which is about an hour here from Delhi. And we also, in advance, on behalf of my own self, the Vice Chancellor and the Chancellor, greet you on your future, you know, Prime Ministership. And a big round of applause to Honorable Peter Dutton for his time. And I also take this moment to thank Dr. Jagvinder Singh Vick, not only for the great work that he has been doing as the chairperson of the India-Australia Strategic Alliance, but what is more important while doing this particular work is to see how the diaspora is being connected, and you are a great ambassador of the country in Australia. So a big round of applause to Dr. Jagvinder Work and his team. I would be failing in my endeavors if I do not take a moment to sincerely thank the Chancellor, Mr. Naveen Jindal, who was supposed to be here but unfortunately could not join us this morning, not only for his philanthropy and the benefaction, but I must tell you all that without his unstinting support and confidence in us, probably we would not live to see this particular day and age wherein we have the O.P. Jindal Global University doing exceptionally good work. And I might be charged for immodesty, but I must place it on record, the kind of work that the university is doing, and it's all possible because of his support and of course the leadership of the Vice Chancellor and his visionary guidance
that makes this possible on a day-to-day basis. But I'm also grateful to all our faculty colleagues, students, and staff members for their contributions to the lofty goals and aspirations that we have, because it's not just the aspirations that we are representing at the OP Jindal Global University for ourselves, but it's the larger societal aspirations of India, and also to bring in a certain harmony amidst the nation states and amongst the nation states in the world at large. So I sincerely thank all the faculty members who took time out to be here with all of us this morning. And I also take this moment to thank the representatives from the government, various ministries, the diplomatic machines, the intergovernmental and international non-governmental organizations for your presence here. It means a lot, because your presence sort of reflects the kind of importance that you are giving to larger India-Australia relations and the work that we all need to do together as members of the broader civil society. End my note here, but not without once again thanking each one of you, and of course the Honorable Peter Dutton for the erudite talk. Thank you all. The meeting has ended, but on behalf of the university, I have a great pleasure in welcoming you all to join us at the reception, and our colleagues will guide you to the place. Thank you so much. Yeah, seize the lift, and further we will guide you. Okay, thank you.
I request everyone to please join us for a short reception at the lawyers' chambers. Our members of the staff will guide you as you exit this hall. You may also press the button C as you take the lift. Thank you.